Okay. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. How about that? The Lord is my shepherd. Psalm 23. Yeah. So, I'm in a bar, and this is just an analogy, kind of, okay? So, let's say I'm in a bar, and or let's say there's a Christian in a bar, and he's talking to everyone in the bar, evangelizing them, saying, brother, you got to, sister, you got to stop drinking. It's not good for you. It leads you away from God and clouds your judgment and causes your life to go off track and leads you down to into hell and fear and death. It's horrible. So won't you, Jesus can help you get sober up and stop drinking. And so they've been evangelizing in this bar for quite some time. And they think they're making some headway. This one says, listening, this one's listening, this one's listening, this one, like, friends with some people. Hi, how you doing? Yeah, I'm back evangelizing you again. I just wonder how you're doing with, are you going to, and you've got some pledges. Say, could you pledge to stop drinking? And you're starting to get pledges from people. And you say, wow, this is amazing. People are finally, the grace of God is getting through to these people. And they've decided to stop drinking. This is great. I mean, I might be able to evangelize everyone in here, and we'll all stop drinking, and that will be fabulous. We're really making progress, Jesus. Thank you so much. So, this is the scene. It's out of the scene. And then, Jesus walks into a bar, into the bar. So it's like a joke. People say, Jesus walks into a bar, and he goes over to you, your evangelizer, the evangelizer, and says, brother, sister, whatever it may be, I want to tell you something. I want to ask you to do something for my sake, okay? And just have faith and trust in me, okay? I want you to walk out of the bar right now. Leave the bar and go home. Leave the bar and go home. And you say, what? But Jesus, I'm making tremendous progress here. This is, you know, I want to help you out. So I'm not going to leave your side. I mean, I want to help you out here. Jesus says, just trust me. Walk, turn around right now. Walk out of the bar. Don't look back and go home. And you say, Jesus, okay, whatever you say, but I'm very confused. This is shocking to me. I thought you really wanted me to help these people, and now you want me to leave these people just when they're pledging to quit drinking like this, and it just, I don't understand at all. So I mean, I will go, but can you at least say something? Why I got, you know, why you're telling me this? It's I can't figure it out at all. I'm very shocked by this. And Jesus said, sure, I can tell you. Now that you've pledged, you're going to leave, I'll tell you. But let's go outside, I'll tell you. So, okay, Jesus, I'll do what you say. You walk outside, don't turn back, you're outside. And so Jesus says, okay, listen. Do you know what time it is in the bar? And you said, no, I'm not really sure. It's getting late, I know that, really late. Well, Jesus says, it was just about ready for last call. Okay, last call in a bar is when the bartender yells, hey, everybody, bar shuts down in 5 minutes. If you want to get your last drink, you got to get it now. It's called last call. And Jesus said, it's last call now in the bar. Okay, and he said, all those people. And he said, you know what? Talk is cheap. Talk is cheap. Anyone can talk a good game. So, all those in the bar, you thought that you were really evangelizing them and they're all committed to no more drink and you thought this was true? Well, I'm telling you right now, right now, they're all back at the bar getting doubles and triples for last call. They'll stop drinking tomorrow, but not today. And I said, whoa, wow. I mean, so you mean I didn't really reach them? Jesus says, not really. And you didn't really reach them? No, not really. Not yet. Not yet. They're not ready yet. Wow. So, this is an analogy. The bar is the world, okay? The alcohol is death. and people are not quite ready to leave death behind yet. But eventually they will. But not yet. And I thought, you know, I'm trying to evangelize the world my whole life. Is, you know, what is death? I know what death is now. I know what death, the decay, aging, death, decay, all of it is. It's very clear in my mind. And so it's, don't need it anymore. Gone. But people are not ready to do that. And the problem with last call is people don't go back just for a little bit of their drink. They realize that if they don't get a drink, you know, now as much as they can, that's it. So they're going to get a huge amount to drink. So we're headed for a huge amount of death in the world. This is what Jesus is saying. So Jesus let me know in the way the grace of God helped me know on Facebook tonight. I just went to one viewer that was like commenting on my stuff. I said, oh, this is great. Someone's really with it. And then I went and saw who it was. I said, whoa, wait a minute. This is like a killer psychopath. And they're basically targeting me. And I went over all their various timeline and stuff and the different language, but I translate a lot of it. And, you know, they're just like, they're psychopaths. They want to kill. And I've been getting some very strange friend requests, worse and worse and worse, more and more psychopathic people. They're coming out of the woodwork right now. So I basically said, last call in the world, but I was saying, okay, death, you know, death, you don't need it anymore, folks. Well, they said, oh, yes, we do. And we're going to really lay it on strong coming up. So at that point, Jesus had shown me, and the Dharma Kings had shown me, this is what's going on, okay? So it's time to walk away, time to walk out of the bar. So I just deactivated my Facebook account. I realized just trying to finesse the whole thing isn't the way. Trying to finesse it is not the way. I said, you know what? If this is how it's going to be, let's just walk away from this. Okay. I don't need the aggravation at all. And this wow practice is so successful. It's so fantastically successful. I want to just concentrate on the wow practice because it works. It will free me from death. There's no question about it. Easily. It's already done deal. So why should I, you know, stay in the bar kind of thing? So again, I just said, okay, and that's it. I went to my settings, privacy settings, security, deactivated my account. Boom. That's it. Just like that. I just said, folks, I'm deactivating my Facebook account for now. I'm going to go focus on the wow practice, and that's it. Again, the friend requests I've been getting are just, I mean, it's just absolutely bizarre, beyond belief. I just, you know, it's like completely opposite of what I would expect. People are basically just, and I understand how it works. You know, death in this world has many guises, and, you know, the male thing would just be to, you know, directly confront you, and the female thing is to friend you first. So they say, oh, I want to be your friend. Hi, how you doing? I like your post, blah, blah, blah. And then you look at their stuff and you realize, you're like, to them, you're the enemy. You're exactly what they want to get rid of. But so they don't, females friend you first, and then they start looking for your insecurities, how, you know, they want to become your confidant, and then you tell them all this stuff, and they say, okay, how can I get this guy? How can I attack him? And how can I bring him down? They're like that. Very sly. Very sly. Men are generally not that way. Those psychopaths are. They look for vulnerability, and they befriend you and say, oh, yeah, I'm going to help you with this, blah, blah, blah. And you think, oh, finally, I have a friend to help me. Turns out they're not. So I said, okay, enough of that. I've seen it for 60 years in this world. This is the world. The world's a lunatic asylum, actually. The religion of the world is death. That's all it is. And it's much ado about nothing. Death is just attempt to fixate the mind. That's all that it is. It's our attempt, our pretending. We just pretend to die. Nothing dies. Nothing's ever died. But we're pretending all this death is happening And we believe that that's the only way to fixate the mind, that this is the way that the mind must be fixated. So that's why people are so loyal to death. You think that you can get them to drop death? No, not so easy. It's the most difficult. Jesus said the last to go will be death. So for me, it's gone. Death is gone. But in telling people this, they just said, whoa, no, we can't handle this. We can't handle this. I said, okay, I'll back off. You know, I can't handle it. And even on here on YouTube, the audience is dwindling severely, very severely. Because they say it's lost last call. Excuse me, I'll be back in a little while. Well, good luck with that. It's now time to dig in and say, no, I'm sticking with it. I'm sticking with it. Sticking with the path. And I told everybody, as a Dharma prince, it's my job to tell everybody there's an easy and simple way to be free of death. Easy, simple for everyone. No problem whatsoever. No problem whatsoever. Just this wild practice, equalizing your evaluations, flattening them. You just, then you can easily see what death is. You don't let go of death until you see what it is. When you see what it is and decay, you say, that's ridiculous. So you get that very clear glimpse of it, and then you just, okay, it's done. Done deal. No problem at all, is it? Not a problem at all. None of this world's a problem at all. So God wants me to have this Psalm 23. He pointed out to me about a month ago or so, and that this is the key. He said, and you commit to me, Psalm 23 is the key. And then I found this like yesterday, or day before yesterday. I just found this. And then I went through a bunch of papers, and I said, I'm going to find something in there. And I just picked this out. What is this? Psalm 23. Right here. And so what he's saying is, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So I said, God, the ball's in your court. I just put the ball in God's court. I said, okay, I'm walking out of the bar. What do I do now? Because I don't know. I've been evangelizing the world my whole life. But Jesus said, it's it. It's time. It's last call. It's not safe anymore. It's not safe anymore. You're going to get too discouraged, and it's going to really discourage you to see what's going to happen. And I said, you know, does it discourage you? He says, no, not at all. And I understand, because he's has the right perspective on it all. And we will, you know, regroup later at some point, and the world will dig in deeper, much deeper, with the right theory, spiritual, theological theory, and get the right theory, and then that will enable them to ultimately see through death and decay. Sickness, aging, death, decay, all that stuff. It's just our attempt to fixate hallucination, to fixate the mind so hallucinating the absence of God remains, not remains, but becomes stable, fixated. So we don't have to keep imagining it, that it's just automatically there without the mind imagining it. Hallucination doesn't work that way. The mind, all hallucination is the mind hallucinating right now. There's no such thing as hallucination that is just there automatically without the mind doing it. Okay, it'll never be that way. So death is futile. It's just a silly, silly imaginary plan we came up with. So maybe if we can make something and claim that it's life, that it's what we are, and then have it stop functioning or freeze up its functioning, that'll mean that mind has been fixated. You know, it's just that silly. Is that silly? So just imagine, well, we're the brain, you know, and so the body stops moving. That means the brain must have frozen up. That means the mind is fixated. You know, just we made this stuff up out of thin air. It's just utterly absurd. It's really that silly. It's just completely silly. Death is completely silly. But people think it's their salvation. You see, so we're still stuck in this, and Jesus knows it. So he said, hey, get out of the bar. Don't look at it anymore. And so I've been continuing to practice golf. Had a very good night's golf conversation with someone today. And I came home, and I told him I've been preparing, so that's great. Really good to hear. Really good to hear. Really, a really great guy. Very spiritual guy, actually. And, I came home and I did some more practicing with the toothpaste. And this time I used the irons, an iron to see. And I found that I was all off, hitting on the toe of the iron. I said, holy cow, I've been hitting it wrong all along. I was not hitting the sweet spot. because with short irons, you tend to pull it in closer to the body, so it hits on the toe. I said, ah, so I fixed that. I had to fix that, and I finally fixed it. It took me quite some time to fix it. So I'm sweet spotting the pitching wedge, sweet spotting the driver, sweet spotting the forward. So I'll keep working to sweet spot these clubs, so I know each club, you know, how to hit it on the sweet spot. And once you can do that with the grip that I have, the ball is going to go where I want it to go, which is great. So, and I went out and got some sunblock, 100 SPF, 100, you know, to really keep the sun off me. So I don't get burned if I'm out in the sun too much, or swimming or whatever. And so I'm heading for Incentiveville. The plan is to incentivize everyone here and say, look, this is what happens when you lead a life of great practice and diligence and steady determination. Wow, look at the fruit, wonderful fruit. So I have to, you know, my job is now to accept the fruits of my labor, so everyone can see. If you choose this tree, the tree of eternal life, and water it, fertilize and weed it, and tend to it really diligently, these are the fruits you're going to get. That's called incentivizing everyone. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to incentivize people, and they're going to say, oh my gosh, look how fortunate he is. And I'll say, well, this is why I'm fortunate. This is the fruits of my labors. I chose the right tree, the tree of no death, the tree of eternal life. I was never consecrated to death here in this world. I never consecrated myself, which is meaningless. Consecrating is meaningless. You're like consecrating yourself to nothing. I mean, that's absurd. Okay, so, but people continuously try to find ways to consecrate themselves to death, thinking it's possible. It's not possible. No one's been consecrated. How can we consecrate ourselves to what can never happen? That's, you know, total absurdity. So incentivizing is to show the fruits. By their fruits ye shall know them, Jesus said. By their fruits ye shall know them. And so the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leadeth me to lie down in green pastures. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Kind of sounds like a golf course, doesn't it? Green pastures and still waters. in other words, for a sheep to he maketh me lie down in green pastures, mean everywhere I look, it's food, abundance, abundance, abundance. And then he leadeth me beside still waters. It means peace of mind, peace of mind. Beautiful, calm, no wind blowing, you know, beautiful weather, calm. So it's instead of, you know, evangelizing anymore, it's time to show the world the fruits of my labors. So I just realized, yeah, it's time. Boom. It's go time. Ready. I'm ready. It's ready time. I'm good to go. I can dial it in. I know how to dial it in. I got my toothpaste ready. I bought some toothpaste today. I said, yeah. I'm ready. But I thought I got the green. I said, what about white? What? I thought this was white. So I may do a switcheroo and go back to the white. It shows up a little better. But it really sticks to the club. It's fabulous. And I just wash it off. It's great, great, great technique there that has been revealed. So, you know, don't worry, those that, there are a lot of, you know, good people on Facebook too, but it was getting too weird. Okay, last call in a bar, it's time to leave the bar, and if your friends want to stay in the bar, it's up to them, it's up to them. I'm not going to force anybody, say, hey, you got to get out of the bar. No, I just lead by example. And down the road, they will see the fruits, you know, of my labors, and that will help them, that will help them. But yeah, there were some promising people there, promising minds, spirits there, in some ways. But Jesus, it's time. That's all there is to it. And so they have to listen to their own spirit and realize it's time. It's time. And you know, what are they going to do? It's time. What are they going to do? It's up to them. So I set the example. You have to lead by example, which is action. See, talk is cheap. Anyone can say, oh yeah, I'm going to leave the bar. But only the ones that actually do it are setting the right example. So, boom, example has been set. Maybe they'll, you know, start watching the videos. Doubtful, because Facebook is like, the way that it is, it's kind of like committing suicide in a way that it becomes superficial. It turns into spirituality. It's not really digging in far enough. So, you know, I pointed that out, and when people, you can tell from their profile and everything that they're totally, you know, radically against what you're saying, and they're the ones liking your posts. You say, I think we're in 1980, Brave New World, 1984. You know, down the rabbit hole here. It's time to. And not everybody was that way. I'm pointing out there were like an example that was happening. But no, there were some that were good too. But again, it's last call time, so it's time to get out. Time to get out of the bar and go back home. First you leave the bar and you're on the street. And you hail a taxi and say, "Hey taxi," or get in your car and say, "Take me home." It's the taxi. I want to go home. Give me your address and the taxi drives you right home. Boom, you're home. And then you relax. Say, "Oh my God, I'm glad I got out of that bar. I hope everybody got out of there, but I'm not really sure that they did. They may have gone back drinking." And the problem is, once you drink at last call, then the people become very belligerent. It hits them so strong, and they realize they're not getting any more for a while. And so the world's likely become very, very nasty now, which I've been telling everyone, this is what's going to happen for years and years and years and years. So, you know, it's going to start. It's going to start. My wife has been sick, and I told her, I said, "That means there's something really bad going to happen in the world." She always gets sick when something really terrible is going to happen. And she's very psychic for some reason. This is not what happens. And I said, "For sure, this means that there's something really, really, really bad is happening in the world." And then she told me, "It's nice." I said, "Hey, did you hear about the thing in Syria and blah, blah, blah?" And she said, "That's horrible. That's trouble. It's really bad trouble." I said, "Yeah, of course. Yeah. So, doesn't matter what it is, for sure. It causes disorientation. Because the world is like spinning now. It's being disoriented. It's last call. Yeah, and people want to, you know, have an orgy of death now. Now we got to make death work. It's our last chance. We really, you know, got to make sure that it fixates the mind. So let's just, you know, pile it on. Man, people were saying, like, on Facebook, this, like, "I don't care if I die. I've got to go kill him. You know, I've got to go kill that guy. I don't care if I die trying, but I got to do it." It's like, wow. Coming from women, you know? I mean, they're... When you say, "I'm done with death, I'm not going to die anymore," they say, "Oh my God, I got to do you a favor, let me kill you." You poor guy. I mean, you've forgotten how to die. I haven't forgotten how to die. There, let me help you die, and you'll thank me later. You know, I saved you. I saved you from the abyss. So there are times when women get really nuts, really crazy, and this is one of those times. And for men, we just can't handle that. Okay. Maybe women can handle that from other women. I don't know. They'll have to decide that for themselves. For men, we can't handle that. We cannot view women in that light. It's too difficult for us. So we just have to take a step back. That's what I did. I realized I can't cope with this. I'm just not able to see women as these vicious killers. You know, I just can't. I know they are, but I always tend to see them in a positive light, very positive light, you know, that they're very gentle, loving, you know, and people, and that's what women, that's how men see women in a positive light, you know, it's that's why we keep getting tricked over and over and over again. We're suckers. We're just suckers. We're born suckers, actually. We're born fools. The whole male thing, we're just born fools. That's a fact. It's all designed that way. We're vulnerable. And keep on serving death, actually. So, I realize I am not able to deal with the viciousness of women right now. So it's just better just to back off. It's just a super wise thing to do for those who identify as a male or man. And pragmatically functioning in the world, that's how I have to function. You know, you open the door. You open the door for the women. You treat them with deference and like a gentleman, and you see them like they're like their mother. You know, they're very, you know, you see them like a very positive influence for life. But of course, keep in mind that the life in this world is really death. So everything that's born in the world is only born in order so that it can die. It's all in the service of death. So women really are totally, as far as giving birth, are totally in the service of death here. That's all they do. They feed death. The feminine, giving birth, it's just feeding death. That's all they do. So they don't want to let go of that. I mean, they think that's salvation. And so they defend it in extremely radical ways that us men simply... It shocks and stuns and demoralizes us too much. We just cannot deal with that. Yeah, we're told, you know, the women are our better half, our companions. You know, that which affirms life. And I think, and then you find out that really they've just been affirming death all along. And it's very disillusioning. And so it's better to just back away from it, you know, until things settle down. Yeah. Got to be humble, right? Got to be humble in this world. And just don't pay any attention. Just don't look at the drivers. Don't pay any attention. Here in the Silicon Valley, my key to driving here, just don't look at any driver. Don't pay any attention. As soon as you do, you think, well, maybe they're angry with me. Maybe they're hostile. Maybe because everybody's so uptight and doing stuff. It's so hard to drive well here because your chain reactions, you're put into situations where you're has to adjust to someone else, and then you end up causing a problem for someone else, and you think, oh, they're really mad at me. But I said, I was just trying to adjust. A man told me a story today where there's this lady, that's pretty woman, let's get over the idea that women are ladies. They're not. This woman said, I was driving home on the street, and this woman was just going so slow and blocking me. It was just driving me nuts. She just was crazy driver. And finally, I said, I just got to get around her, and I just floored it and went around her really fast. As I was going, must have been going 90 miles an hour. I was going really fast. And lo and behold, I look in my rearview mirror, and I see a policeman back there. I said, ah, I'm in trouble. You know, son of a gun. Well, policeman pulled him over. And he said, license? I don't have my registration. I'm smogging it right now. I just sent it in. He says, okay. Insurance? Ah, I said, I don't know where it is. I may have forgotten to put it. He says, ah, okay. And he says, you know, I pulled you over. He says, yeah, but you know what I was doing was that woman driver was just driving so erratic. I couldn't take it anymore. I had to go around her. And he says, yeah, I know. I saw the whole thing. I was following her. And so I understand what you did. And he said, but you understand, I had to pull you over. You're doing 90 miles an hour. I mean, you can't be a policeman and seeing a guy speeding like that and not pull you over, right? And he says, yeah, I understand. He says, okay. I'll just give you a little courtesy note here and have a great day. And you just let him go. And I said, yeah, common sense. America lives. Common sense lives. So the policeman knew that woman, I mean, she was on drugs or drunk or something. And he was following her. But then this guy's like speeding and he had to, you know, he had to pull him over, so to speak. Interesting, huh? There's people would be saying, why are you so, if he pulled the woman over, why are you so biased to pull the woman over? That guy was going 90 miles an hour. You should have pulled him over. You see how women get away with stuff, or whoever gets away with it. But the guy got pulled over. But the policeman said, look, I had to do this. It just, you know, it wouldn't look good if I didn't pull you over, right? But I understand what you did, and it's okay. No problems. Go ahead. Go. And I said, oh, hallelujah, man. Really? You see, that's what guys can do. They're like that. They can apply. He said, look, I understand. And, you know, I had to pull you over. I hope you don't mind that. He said, no, I'm okay. I understand too. He said, okay. Poof, gone. There's no worries. And this other man told me about his his mom and his mom's his two aunts, three sisters, and there was an outing, and they had to leave them all behind. He says they cannot get along. They've been fighting their entire life. They've kept grudges at one another their entire life, and they'll just ruin the outing for us. We just have to leave them at home, and they get mad about it. But you know, we're not going to ruin our time by having them fighting with one another. And then there's another grandmother told me that raising daughter, she said it was hell. They never forgive one another. They're fighting, they hold grudges. It's just horrible. The men, they fight, they say sorry, make up, friends, gone. That's it. So it's very different. Very different. So right now, you know, women are not yet ready to realize that they've only been feeding death. That's all they've been doing here in this world. They're not the heroes of life at all. Nobody is here as a hero of life. This is just all, this realm is a realm of trying to believe in death and believing in death, trying to pretend to keep dying, to believing that can fixate the mind so that hallucination is stable and we don't feel so insecure, hallucinating the absence of God. That's all that it is. And they're not ready yet to see that. Whereas some men are. I'm totally ready to see that. But I can understand that women are not yet ready to see it. I mean, I sympathize with it. So it's not like I'm blaming them or anything. I'm just pragmatically saying, you know, hey, I got to be protected from them right now because they're not on the same page. They're not ready. What I mean is spirit is not yet ready to drop the feminine thing, which is producing the food, you know, feeding that feeds death, the bodies. That's how we keep feeding death through bodies. At least we're pretending to feed death. There's really no death and no bodies, and nothing's ever happened. It's everything is all ready. It's always been spontaneous in the now, total freedom. For our freedom has never left us at all. So this is just imaginary pretend play we're engaged in, but it seems pretty real to us. So yeah, the females are just not ready for that. They're gonna need to, you know, they're gonna drink at the last call heavily, and get their boyfriends and, you know, men to do it also with them. Hey, I don't want to drink alone. Come on, guys, don't make me look bad here, right? And the guys will say, oh, gentlemen, okay, I'm sorry, I don't want to, because the women will say, man, if you don't drink with us, we're gonna look like we're like killers. We're gonna be terrible. Aren't you gonna do some killing for us along with us? And they, oh yeah, I don't want you to look so bad. I'll be the gentleman. But you know, there's no more ladies in the world right now, and so there's really no room for any more gentlemen anymore. So we got to stop this stupid gentleman thing, really, just pretending, you know, that the women are such wonderful, you know, life affirming beings. They're not. They're not. This whole play of male and female is just a play of death. That's all that it is. But fortunately, we can set it down. Very easy to set it down. But the wild practice just... the ego, the self-evaluating, everything that is using death, okay, trying to use death to fixate the mind, it just becomes inert, kind of. It just stops functioning easily. And so the path is easy. It's easy. This practice points out just how easy it is. It's just our insane loyalty to death that makes it seem difficult, and our doubt that makes it seem difficult. It's easy practice. Easy and fun and super effective. But this is where people, they can't do it. You know, they say, no, I got to go back to the bar and drink with my, you know, lady love, because I don't want her to look so bad by contrasting with me. Well, that's, you know, playing the fool. For what? For what? For what? It's time to stop playing the fool. And of course, men have to do it first. The women are not going to abandon death yet. It's too much of a shock for them. They thought that they were like this wonderful, superior, awesome center of God, center of all creation, you know, and all creation revolves around them. And then they find out that all I've been doing is feeding imaginary death. And that's not it. And it's like, they think that women are spiritual. You know? No, spirit is spirit. Women and men are just stick figures in a dream that spirit is dreaming. There's no spirituality to men or women at all. Okay, they don't even exist actually, except as in a dream. And so spirit's been believing that women are real, and this bodies and people are real, and all these dream figures are real, and they're so spiritual because they're helping create a new creation by feeding death. And the death will ultimately, what spirit hopes, is that death will ultimately fixate the mind, and then we won't need death anymore. We'll be free of death once the mind is fixated. That's the whole Jesus thing of Christians say, well, Jesus, that's a real death, that his death fixated the mind. And now, therefore, we don't need death anymore. That's their belief, which is, you know, totally absurd. Because that's actually believing that we can have a new creation. Creation of, with the absence of God. But first we have to fixate hallucination, which means fixate the mind, so that they think that they believe the crucifixion of Jesus fixated the mind. So God so loved this new creation, this world, that he gave his only Son, the Son of God, to die, in other words, to fixate the mind, so this world would be forever and ever. We could have all this death and decay and or whatever, this world of time, space, process, and form, but free of death. You know, we'd have this wonderful bodies and animals and nature and all this, you know, decay. But I don't know how they're not really answered that question about decay, have they, and aging and stuff. But we have this paradise where we didn't age, things would decay, and you know, and we'd be able, because the mind's finally been fixated, and we don't have to, all our insecurities gone. Well, this is a pipe dream, you know, it's lunacy. Jesus doesn't have any power to fixate the mind. God doesn't even have the power to fixate the mind. God gave himself away as freedom. So there's no way to fixate the mind. It's impossible. So we're not going to have this new age of a world, a spiritualized world, where we're free of death because we don't need it anymore because it was successful. We finally found a way for death to fixate the mind, therefore we don't need death anymore. No. We're only free of death when we realize that death can never do anything to fixate the mind. It's all been futile from the beginning. And really, nothing has ever died at all. It's only been pretending. Death is completely impossible, actually. Only then, when we realize death's impossible, it's never happened, well, then we stop trying. So why should I keep trying to do the impossible, which and nothing's even happening at all with that? It's all pretending. I'm just pretending to die. But pretense is not real. It never was real. Like when you're pretending to be sick, you're not really sick. You never were sick. And you can get well, and instantly you just stop pretending. Did you get well? No, you didn't get well. You just stopped pretending. So, this is what's really going on here. And I know this may sound like, oh, I can't understand this. That's okay. I understand it. I get it. And because of right theory, you know, seeing how this whole dream of the world, death and all this stuff, why is it even here? It's ridiculous, isn't it? If God didn't create death, I mean, that's even in the Bible, you know. Didn't create time, space, process, or form, none of that. So it has to be our dream. So it's once you get theory right, theology right, and all this stuff, then it becomes really easy. And then you do the practice, and the more you practice, the more clear it becomes to you. But it's a difficult process because our expectations, we keep exceeding them. I mean, we're just like, wow, that's great, but my expectations just got exceeded. And that's kind of rough. So it goes like that. We're going to get rain here tomorrow night. A good bunch of storms coming through. Boom, 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 like that. Boom, 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 boom. Get quite a bit of rain coming in. I don't know how much we'll get. Maybe as much as an inch or more. Maybe more in the mountains. And it's pretty a lot for April, kind of. It'll juice up the state even more with greenery. That'd be just like, right now it's, you know, the sun's out and things are starting to dry out, and suddenly here comes more rain. Oh my gosh, it's going to just provide even more bloom. But I'm not really interested in that so much right now. I'm interested in the practice and, you know, backing off, you know, getting out of that bar, going back home. And like the Lonely Teenager song by Dion, it's I'd love to go back home. I'd love to go back home, back where I belong. I know I'll be all right if I just stay out of sight, if I just stay out of sight, yeah, if I just stay out of sight. So basically what that song was introduced to me saying, look, you'll be all right as long as you just stay out of sight. That's it. So I may very well just stay out of sight for a while. I don't even know if I'm going to post on YouTube. I might. Depending, you know, it depends. If nobody watches, I might not. But off of social media, pretty much. Yeah, Facebook. And I'm not, just going to stay out of sight. And I'll be all right. And again, it's too tough for men right now. They need to do this. They need to take refuge because the disillusionment that they're going to experience with women is such that it just can't take it. I mean, I don't care who you are. Just, you know, it's just too much to take. We have this idealized image of women that's really burned into us. And, you know, we'll do just about anything to protect that idealized image of women that we have. And when you see women behaving badly, it just says, oh my gosh, I just have to do what they're doing so they don't look so bad. I can tell them, yeah, I'm doing it too. You know, you're fine. You're not bad. Look, we're both doing it. You know, that's like playing the chivalry. It's chivalry. And there's no time to be chivalrous right now. You've got to back away from chivalry. Yeah, chivalry is dead. Chivalry is dead. And you got to let it rest in peace. You know, I know there's no death, but there is the death of chivalry. There's the cessation, let's say, of chivalry for now. The inertness, let's say, the inertness of chivalry. So let's just let chivalry die. Let us lose interest in chivalry at this point. There's a real danger for men right now. Very, very dangerous time. And I couldn't post that on Facebook. I was trying, but the women were just jumping on me. They said, we got to tackle this guy and bring him down. And so, you know, they didn't like the message, really. So here, you know, it's probably the same thing. Probably the same thing. So action speaks louder than words, and we'll see what the Longchamp and Apex Array and the Dharma Kings and the Holy Spirit and the grace of God will do here now. And Psalm 23 is what they gave me. He says, where is my shepherd? I shall not want. I'm the sheep. God is the shepherd. And he's saying, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. Yeah. So that the real key, I guess, is finally been able to expose here is that I just can't take women behaving badly. I really can't. And I don't think any men can, actually. So we just have to not be aware of it. Just not be aware of it. Pay no attention to it. Otherwise, we're going to jump in and say, hey, don't worry, I'm even worse. You're still ideally wonderful because look how much worse I am than you. And that's what happens. Women say, we're going to start killing everybody. And men say, no, we'll do it for you. Don't worry, we're the killers. You're life affirmers. You know, the women smile. Say, okay, yeah, you're so wonderful. As long as you do the killing for me. Yeah, that's they're just like that. Existence like that. If men refuse to do the killing, women will do the killing. If men refuse to behave badly, women will behave really badly. Protecting what they think is their sanity. Believing that no evaluation is an abyss. Instead of realizing no evaluation is because all value is everywhere always. That's God. So they're terrified of ending this dream of evaluation, this what they think is a new creation of disproportionate value. So they keep trying to say, we got to fixate the mind. We just have to fixate the mind. The only way that we've come up with the ultimate solution is death. So they're super loyal to death. And if the men won't do it, they will do it. They will do it. And again, men just cannot handle that. The men will say, no, I don't want you to be a killer. You know, let me be that for you. No, my hero, yeah. No, my fool, my idiot fool. Yeah, they're not happy. Let them do what they got to do, what they want to do. Let it be on them so they feel it and they're ashamed. And so that then, to this next cycle of existence, they say, wow, we got to turn now to the truth, and we got to stop this nonsense. I've had enough of it. I'm not going to do it anymore. I'm going to find out what's really going on here. So But they'll be the last. I mean, death is the last to go, and women are the great defenders of death. They're the ones who believe they have the most investment in it, producing bodies to feed death with. So they'll be the last to be liberated. And so, you know, they'll die hard. I mean, they'll let go of death hard. We heard, like, dying hard. Well, they're going to let go of death hard. And it's not a pretty picture. It's not a pretty picture. They really, and men should not have to bear witness to that, actually. They should not. And they shouldn't have to bear witness to their brothers being fools and being chivalrous fools either. They shouldn't have to bear witness to that because that's embarrassing, you know, very embarrassing. Very shameful and embarrassing. Wow. You know, it's time for men to stop being idiots, okay? Being fools like that. We're better than that. We've got to draw a line and say, you know, enough is enough. We're through with this idiocy of trying to fix it in mind through death. And we know Jesus told us, hey, we're children of eternal life. We're not children of death at all. So we're not going to go down that road. And we understand women will go down that road for a little while longer. That's fine. That's what they got to do. So it's time for men to be wise instead of chivalrous fools. Okay, it's time for us to be wise about all this. Saying, okay, I understand that they have, there's some difference there, that most women are going to really hang tough with death and say, no, we're gonna stick it out and see if it will finally work. And then if it doesn't work, then forget it. But we're going to try, you know, one more time. And of course, it will never work. So it's ridiculous. And, you know, maybe many of you don't understand, what am I talking about? Well, you'll find out soon enough what I'm talking about. But you should have this, you know, feeling within you, yeah, the feeling is there, I understand it that way, but is it really going to be like that? You know, can't I keep my idealized image and hang out with, no, not really, not really. It's err on the side of caution. It's a dangerous, dangerous time. Jesus says, leave the bar. It's too dangerous for you. You're not going to be able to handle it. Because when you see women behaving badly, you're going to jump in and say, I'm much worse here. And they'll start acting out much worse just to save the image you have of them. He said, that's too dangerous for you. Leave the bar. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Grace of God. Thank you, Dharma Kings. Thank you, Longchampan, Apex Array, and Sri Sri Anandamai Maharaj Maharshi, Jamian Kenshi Choki, Lodur Manjushri, Padma Samava, Jesus Christ, and Longchampa, and, you know, the Dharma Kings, you know, thank you for being so wise like this and not being chivalrous fools, right? Not expecting me to be a chivalrous fool. None of my mom green-lighted it all. She green-lighted this. She green-lighted my deactivating the Facebook account. She green-lighted it. Said, go time. Do it. Yeah, you got my permission. So I said, that's all I needed. I saw that. Boom. Done deal. She green lights something. You know it can't be wrong. Nothing to drink out here, huh? I didn't bring anything. Well, that's okay. I ate a lot today because it's stressful time, isn't it, right now in the world? Sure it is. Good time to have your golf swing grooved, isn't it? Really good time. No, I had to make some alterations in my stance. I mean, I had to open my stance up. Before it was closed, I opened it up with my pitching wedge. I said, wow, when I have it the other way, I keep pulling the club in too far and hitting on the toe. But when I opened my stance up, boom, I started hitting on the sweet spot every time. I said, well, okay, got to do it. My back kind of hurts from a little bit. I don't know. Back always aches a little bit with golf, it seems like. But in laws, it's not too bad. Great time to be ready for golf. That my friend told me, wow, it's a really smart thing you did to really work out and be ready like this. So he somehow he felt it, like, you know what? I think you're really, really smart guy. He's a very wise person himself, actually. Quite unusual person, to say the least. But liable to be chivalrous, you know, right? Not many men that have finally decided, you know, enough's enough. This is all just, this game goes nowhere except hell. Okay, so it's time to stop this idiotic game, because these figures are just dream figures. It's spirit that's trying to fixate the mind, not bodies or people at all. You know, the bodies and people are just dream figures, really, of spirit. Spirit's the one dreaming all this. We call it mind, spirit, mind with a capital M. So, wow. So I gave you the wow practice before, and I've been doing that a lot. I will continue. But not many are, I see whenever I see wow practice, not many people watch it, because they're afraid. It's too effective. They don't want something that's effective. They want to be chivalrous and be spiritual at the same time, and you can't do that. Because this practice will help you see what's going on. And you'll have to say, wow, that's the end of that. And so there's this conflict, like, how do I, you know, keep an idealized image of women? Well, back away from the whole thing. Back away from it. And if wise women, back away from it too. Back away from it too. But don't expect the men to be chivalrous for you at all. And wise women can be that way. They can say, hey, don't be a hero for me. That's stupid. I don't need any contrast. I'm repenting myself, and I'll, you know, I'm working through this whole thing myself. But so don't you be a fool for me. I don't want that. I don't need it. That's what they say, of course. But, you know, things get tough. They might sing a different tune. But that's very possible. But anyway, you don't, you know, let this all, okay, back away from it. Back away. Everybody, let's take a break from one another. Back away. Let's no one be chivalrous. No one be a fool for what's going on. Let it play out. Let it play out. And, you know, the women just say blatantly, hey, if you guys don't want to do this, we're going to do it. Okay. We're going to be the heroes of the world. We're going to save death. Okay. Knock yourself out. Heroes of the dream of death. What's that? There's no death. How can you be a hero of death? There's no such thing. You know, how can you be a hero of fixating the mind? The mind can never be fixated. This is just all empty talk. It's just completely empty. So I'm really looking forward to tonight, and sleeping, dreaming, getting up tomorrow, and, you know, the Lord is my shepherd now. So that's very exciting. And can't wait to see how that plays out, and experience how that plays out. And it's all good, you know, it's all good from this point on. I mean, the helpfulness is like part of the fruit of helpfulness that will be available later on. Hopefully some of you can catch yourself in time and just realize, hey, wow, I better get out of this bar also. Otherwise, I'm going to fall. And now that you know what the fall is, you know, being chivalrous, providing a contrast to keep your idealized image, then you realize, oh my gosh, yeah, I don't want to make that mistake either. Now, you could be married. That's fine. I'm married. I'm going to do it anyway, right? And hopefully my wife doesn't behave badly, which she could at some point, but maybe not. Let's see if I can keep her away from it all, too. She's detached from it all. At least she says she is, but she still keeps up with the news, you know, a little bit, but doesn't watch television, doesn't radio, nothing. She's very, very, pretty much doesn't pay any attention to the world at all, either, but just a tiny bit. And her friends kind of tell her stuff. She talks to friends. So she's for a woman, she's like super, super detached, actually. Super detached. But they cannot quite detach as much as men, basically. They still want to say, well, who's killing who? You know, who's dying? They still want to, oh, someone died, yeah. I don't need to read the bits. I've stopped really even checking the weather, because even on the weather page on the internet, they've got all this death stories and death this and death this and advertises like somebody died, 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 tragedy, 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 tragedy. I don't need that anymore. I am through with that nonsense. I don't even check the weather. I just, you know, I just go to YouTube to upload the videos. But other than that, I'm going to just try to stay off the internet altogether. I may even stop uploading to YouTube. I use this piece of paper to shield, like, when that, you know, the banner on YouTube, the advertisement, which is usually a movie, a gory movie, I just put this near my face, and it blocks that part of the screen out. And so I don't see that. So I recommend using cards like that to just block while something's page is loading until you can finally then click and get to the page you want to. They make you watch the advertisements. Just block it like that. That's what I do with YouTube. I just block it. And you cannot trust, you know, everything that YouTube says. They say that it's okay to post these songs by various artists, and they're not blocked in any country. He says, but that could change at any moment, you know. And so they're kind of wishy-washy about it. Well, someone just got their account deleted because they were just posting songs from the 60s and the, you know, past bygone eras, and on their account. It said, account has been terminated due to multiple third-party copyright claims. But they, if you look up on their copyright rights page, almost every single artist, except I think the Beatles and a couple others, what are those other ones? I can't quite remember what they are. But there's a few that still bring copyright claims against people. But other than that, they say everybody, other than Germany and a few countries, but most of the places, every song you're allowed to post on YouTube without problems. But they say that could change at any time, and someone could still make a claim against you. So it's, you know, they're trying to have their cake and eat it too. They're saying, everybody, go ahead and post songs, because that's what generates our revenue. I mean, most of the clicks on YouTube are on songs, music, by artists. You know, copyright infringement, that's where they get all their clicks and their advertising revenue. So what they tell you is, oh yeah, don't worry. You know, as long, you know, you don't have to take any action. We'll just say there's copyright thing claim, but there's no action you need to take, and shoot, you know, unless we notify you. So people just upload all these songs, and then YouTube gets, you know, you see some of these songs, like 60 million hits, and, you know, 80 million hits. It's incredible. That's a massive revenue for YouTube. But on the other hand, then they're terminating accounts because people, copyright holders, are complaining. But you don't see the accounts with the massive viewership being terminated. So these accounts that they have, like, you know, these, all these, you know, popular songs with 20, 30 million views, they're not ever terminated. Why? Because the artists are making money off those views. That's why. Because they monetize it, and they get a percentage of the views. Something like that. So it's money. It's money. It's money. It's advertising. I think, like Taylor Swift, I think you can't put her songs up either. And there's a few more. A couple of not so well-known artists. And of course, they get advertising, but they get some, so somehow they get some sort of kickback. I'm not exactly sure. Maybe it might be their official, they have official YouTube accounts or something too. But by and large, if something's getting a lot of views, it's allowed to stay on. Weird. Weird, huh? Yeah. So I've refrained from putting anything up, any songs up, and the Holy Spirit keeps telling me, no, 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 don't do it. You might have your account deleted. And they say, but yeah, but they say it's okay. No, it's not necessarily okay. It's not necessarily okay. So I decided, no, I'm not going to do any sing-alongs at this point in that way. So amazing time, huh, to see all this. So I'm gonna sleep on it. What time is it? 10:30. I'm gonna sleep on it. And see how I feel in the moment. I mean, it's a drastic step, but I've taken many drastic steps in my life. When I decided I'm done with something, you know, I'm done. It's cold turkey. I just walk away and said that I'm finished. The Holy Spirit made it clear, too dangerous, you're done. That's it, and don't go back, basically. Just don't go back. Unless the Holy Spirit says so. Right? Yeah. But as far as, you know, I'm not making any plans to go back. I just say, no, that chapter's finished. There's no reason to go back to a chapter you already read. You want to read the new chapter. So we want to read this new chapter, full stop on the wow. Wow. Everything's going great. Wow. Nothing's going great. Wow. This is wonderful. Wow. This is terrible. Wow. I don't know what I'm doing. Wow. I do know what I'm doing. Wow. And again, just keep playing with these opposites and digging into your psyche this way and finding sense of errors. I found some sense of errors today. I really did. I was like, oh, gosh. I got to say the opposite of that and have the same evaluation. Wow, that's tough. Yeah, but I did it. There's certain areas where you want to have different evaluation. And what you have to do is find those areas and make sure you put the exact same evaluation on them. And you will find yourself getting a little bit sensitive, like, oh, I hit a nerve there. And that's what you need to do. You need to do your own practice and find the sensitive areas where the stuff that you just like, oh, I'm defending that. I'm protecting that from from same evaluation. I want to have differing evaluations of this and that. That's what you have to find in your practice. So looks like our 1 hour is just about right for now. I'm going to. I don't know what I'm going to do. Who knows, right? Who knows? The Lord is my shepherd. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. Hallelujah. Right? He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He restoreth my soul. My spirit numbers, my confidence, my feeling that you know, beingness and nowness. And he leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. True righteousness. Of being right. Meaning this is all just a dream. That evaluation is just an attempt to fixate hallucination, that there's nothing to evaluate in reality. And then he, for his name's sake, in other words, for his sake, for the sake of God, he sets me right so that everyone can see the example, the incentivization for his sake. He's helping incentivize me for his sake so that we all go back to realizing that God is still God and we're still a son of God, and we have all value everywhere always. So he's going to incentivize me, use me as an incentive for others. So that's great. I'll be looking great, living great, and enjoying the fruits of my labors. And so then at some point people can see, look, hey, this is You work on the right way, you get the fruits of your labors, right? You work the wrong way, you get the bitter fruit of those labors. You support death and a champion of death. What do you get? You get death. The church, the Catholic Church, for instance, is a church of death, consecrating everyone to death. And what are they going to get? They're going to die. When you are a champion of death, you're going to die. Obviously. You end up devouring yourself. The idea of death reaches you. You know, projections don't leave the source. So the Catholic Church is going to die. It's already dying. No question about it. It's in its death throes right now. As is the world. The world is going to die because the world is a place consecrated to death. What do you think? You can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't believe in death and not die. Believing in death, I mean, you become a sacrificial agent of death to try and empower it. The whole idea of death is we're trying to empower ourselves through death. We're trying to empower a new creation through death. So, of course, if we're still desiring a separate new creation from God, empowering it through death is what we're doing, we're going to end up dying to try and empower ourselves. At least we think we're going to die. I mean, we'll go through what we believe in our imagination is dying. So the church believing that it's empowered a new creation through death, okay, the insecurity is still there. It's got no, it's little choice but to, you know, itself die, thinking that's the final step to consecrate the new creation is the ultimate death of the whole entire church. Yeah. So that's what's coming. Unfortunately, because, you know, we put a lot of effort into the church throughout 2,000 years. A lot of art, a lot of culture, a lot of building, a lot of infrastructure, a lot of prayer, a lot of hope, a lot of fear, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. And you know, it's not, I don't want to be around for that either. I really don't. See, I have an idealized religion too, of religion and the church, and I don't want to see it go through its death either, your destruction. I don't. So that's another thing. I might jump in there and say, you know, take me instead, you know, that kind of thing. Because just, you know, all the stained glass, you know, and the beautiful cathedrals and the beautiful pomp and circumstance and the beautiful hope and longing and the good works and the saints and the statues and all the beautiful, everything that we've done, the workmanship, the craftsmanship, the dedication, it goes on and on and on, right? It's like our crowning jewel of our last 2,000 years, to see it die. I don't want to see that. I don't want to see that at all. I mean, my God, I composed a lot of music for the church. You know, that's used a lot in church, has been used a lot to glorify the church. I compose a lot of music for the church. And I did a lot to try to glorify the church, so, in previous lives. So, I don't want to see the church die. I'd love to reform it, but it's not going to be reformed. It's dying. And you don't want to see the Virgin Mary, you know, burned at the stake, but that's what's going to happen. It's going to die. The church is going to die. And along with it, all the myths and all the, you know, the hopes and fears and everything like that. And so that's another idealized image. So there's a lot, all these idealized images are going to die. And we don't have to put ourselves through that. We'll go to an intermediate zone, hang out for a while, play some golf, take it easy. And we know it's dying, but it's a death we don't really want to see, okay? And we'll come to terms with it. I'm absolutely confident of that. That we'll have a good laugh and say, well, we knew that would happen, but it's okay because now we know that we live, and we've always lived. We never fell from grace at all. We'll realize that. And since when we realize we never fell from grace at all, we'll realize that the whole church thing was just, a song and a dance that we needed to do, we did to honor our creativity. But that's all. And we'll have honor in our hearts for it. And then it's time to start dancing the dance of glory once again, right? It'll be like that. So I know we'll come to terms with it. I'm positive of that. I'm 100% positive. I know already in my mind I've come to terms with it. But in the short term, it's difficult. But in long term, I know 100% for sure how to come to terms with that our folly, you know, our folly. It's a beautiful folly in some ways, right? It's a beautiful folly. But there's a time where you need to back away, and then in the longer term, you look back kind of fondly, like, wow, that was really a beautiful folly, but it folly it was. And now I'm done with folly. But I'm okay with it all. I'm okay. I'm fine with it. I'm already fine with it. I'm not going to watch the death throes of it all, you know? No. I could be pulled back into chivalrous action, which would benefit absolutely no one. It would set everybody back very badly, actually. All right. Very great. Just the wow practice is where it's at. The wow practice is truly where it's at. I know most of you are not doing it. Can't quite do it yet. Theory doesn't support it in your mind. You think it's too drastic a step. You want to have some evaluation between good and bad and all this kind of stuff. Not quite realizing what God really is. All value everywhere, always. It's always been that way, always will be that way. But you'll get glimpses of it. You'll get glimpses, and you'll say, well, I know someday I will do it. Someday I will do it, and you will. You will do it someday. But you don't want to get hooked into, you know, this folly that's coming. And so I'm working to try and, you know, see what God will do to help as many as possible to back away and before they really get pulled into the folly of it all. Okay. Very great. That's it. Wow.